welcome to this webinar. Thank you for being here and participating in the webinar session. We are here to listen to Dr. Bianchini's speech about applications of cultural planning to urban policies. I've known Dr. Bianchini for more than 1 year. He kindly accepted to be my thesis advisor. His main research interests are in the area of cultural planning and cultural policies. Therefore, we asked him to share his experience and expertise with us, and he kindly accepted our invitation. So I really appreciate Dr. Bianchini. I really appreciate your favor, and it's a pleasure and honor for us to have you here. Now I would like to ask Dr. Pirbabayi to continue and maybe add something to my words.
Thank you very much. Thank you everybody for participating in this webinar. I would like to greet Dr. Bianchini and express my gratitude to him for his presence. I would also like to thank our academic staff and faculty members present in this webinar. Finally, I must mention that I am grateful to Mr. Nilipur for arranging and organizing this webinar. Dr. Franco Bianchini, the Associate Director, Center for Cultural Value in UK and Visiting Professor, the Sibelius Academy, University of the Arts in Helsinki. His books include focus on festivals published in 2015, Urban Mindscapes of Europe published in 2006, Planning for the Intercultural City published in 2004, Culture and Neighborhoods, a comparative report published in 1997, The Creative City published in 1995, and Cultural Policy and Urban Resignation, the West European Experience, published in 1993. His books, The Creative City and the Urban Mindscape of Europe, has been translated into Farsi. And today he is going to speak about applications of cultural planning to urban policy. Dr. Bianchini, would you please start your presentation?
Thank you. I would like to thank the university and also Mehdi in particular for the invitation. It's the first time that I give a lecture in Iran, but it is a country that I've always been very fascinated with, and including obviously because partly of the cultural continuity between Italy, where I come from, and Iran. There are many parallels, and I have had the privilege of meeting many Iranians in Italy. Particularly people who were studying at the University of Florence when I was doing my first degree in politics in Florence at the beginning of the 1980s. I hope it will be possible in not too distant future when we are allowed to travel again to visit your country as well. The idea of this lecture, if we start from the first slide, is to show the relevance of this approach described as cultural planning. And starting from the second slide, you all have, I think, the presentation. I start precisely from the book which has just been mentioned, the Creative City book, published in 1995, where a book that starts from three different kinds of research, partly from research on urban cultural policies, city cultural policies, that I've been involved in from the beginning of my of my work in the late 1980s. Secondly, the publication of a monumental book by Peter Hall called Cities in Civilization. That is a study of the most creative periods in the history of cities, starting from Athens in 500 BC and continuing until Los Angeles in the 1990s. And the third piece of research was some research on psychological aspect activity, asking if some of the lessons that we have from psychological research on creativity could be applied to cities and to urban policy. So today, slide number three, the discourse on the creative city is increasingly popular. There are many creative cities strategies across the world, but it is a discourse that tends to ignore a number of trends that are actually probably undermining urban creativity and innovation. So if we look at slide number four, of a shopping mall, and as you can see, it's not clear where you are. It could be, it is actually a picture of an English city, Leicester, but you could be probably in Iran as well. You could be in Australia, in Italy, anywhere. So this phenomenon of the standardization and corporatization of city centers, city centers becoming increasingly cloned, increasingly similar, even countries like Iran or Italy, with a very rich tradition of architecture, it seems that even these countries in the contemporary period are not trying to build a new contemporary style, even for everyday buildings like a shopping mall, and they tend to copy models that are making cities much more standardized, or as Charles Landry said in one of his books, there is a phenomenon of Starbucksification of cities. Then if we go to slide number five, we find that one of the problems of cities today is that although, like in Europe, cities are not actually growing in population, nevertheless, the body of the city is growing, is expanding into the countryside, the surrounding areas, and we have increasingly a phenomenon of a large out-of-town shopping centers characterized by massive car parks, a phenomenon of hypertrophy, of urban sprawl, that is again making cities much more difficult to manage. And this is a big problem because we are now trying, across the world, we are trying to reduce, to combat climate change, but our cities are very difficult to organize in terms of public transport because now they have become too big. So we are too reliant on the car, on the private car. So if we go to slide number six, we find that one of the characteristics of urban sprawl is also that urban sprawl today is not just about shopping and it's not just about residential housing, but it is also about entertainment. Increasingly, we have a closure of city center cinemas and the opening of cinemas and fitness locations like places where you can play bowling or leisure centers, gyms, are located outside cities and they're only reachable by car. In places that Marc Auger, the French anthropologist, in his famous book, describes as known places. So this is one of the big challenges we had. And perhaps the coronavirus crisis, with the closure of many restaurants, many theaters, many leisure facilities, perhaps gives us the opportunity to rethink these out-of-town places, perhaps to reduce the number of out-of-town leisure facilities. Now we go to slide seven, which is about the problem which has become evident since the financial crash of 2007-2008, that a crash that produced a very deep recession in the majority of Western countries, and a recession that led also to the imposition of austerity policies by governments in the West, with the reduction of public expenditure. And this produced a reduction in leisure time for people working. Many people in Italy, in Spain, in Greece, in Portugal, in other countries very badly affected by the financial crash of 2007-2008, now have to do two jobs to earn the same amount of money. So they have to work much longer, longer hours. So they have less time for free time activities, for leisure, for culture, for going to parks, for recreation. This problem is especially acute for women who are progressing in terms of their position in the labor market, but they still have a lot of responsibilities related to household responsibilities and children, childcare. So we have a problem of reduction of leisure time, a problem of work-life balance with an increase in mental health problems in Western countries, an increase of anxiety and depression also among young people who are struggling to find a job, who are struggling to find the money to be able to buy their own home and to start a family. So we have a problem of this kind. But we also have a problem of acceleration of the rhythm of life in the city. So, for example, there are very clear data showing that people are sleeping less, just because they are worried, but just also because they are trying to fit in more things in their working, in their day, their normal day. So there is a reduction in our sleeping time, and there is also the disappearance of moments of relaxation that characterize, for example, Mediterranean cities in Europe until recently. So, for example, less and less people are doing the siesta after lunch. They are not resting after lunch in Mediterranean countries. The lunch time itself is reducing. It has now become only 28 minutes on average in the UK, in the United Kingdom, for example. So we are losing this value of slowness. Slowness is an important value, especially of Mediterranean, Middle Eastern country. The word slow, as you know, in English, is often regarded as a negative word, which means often retarded, thick, not very intelligent. But slow in ancient Greece, the word slow was associated with the idea of creative leisure. That was one of the most noble expressions of human life. Therefore, perhaps we need to recover this positive sense of slowness, and in a way the pause of the lockdown in due to the virus crisis has given us perhaps a possibility to reflect on the importance of slowing down. People have been traveling obviously much less, and they have had this opportunity to reflect. So how can we recover some of the positive values of slowness by developing a new management model for cities that combines ideas coming from the Middle East, from the Mediterranean, with ideas that come from Anglo-Saxon and Northern European countries? Is one of the big challenges. There are some ideas contained in this website, slowmovement.com. If we go to slide number 8, this slide is about the smartphones and the the digital information revolution, which is obviously very positive in terms of giving us access to knowledge and information, of course also access to a lot of false information, a lot of misleading information. Nevertheless, it has been very important, of course, to survive also our experience of the impact of the pandemic in the last few months. But nevertheless, we also have to recognize some of the problems, and these are not sufficiently recognized in urban policies, in urban cultural policies. Problems of the effects of the digital information overload, particularly for children and young people, on memory, on empathy, empathizing with real people rather than with people on a screen, on our quality of writing and our ability to concentrate. We have a more and more fragmented concentration with reduced attention spans, according to studies of children, for example, conducted in the United States. So if we go to slide number 9, this is about another aspect of the entertainment culture of the last few years, which is the idea of the nighttime economy. I was associated myself with introducing this idea in the UK as a positive idea, as the idea of opening up the nighttime as a space for conviviality, for people meeting in cafes, bars, restaurants, especially important as people were working harder and harder. It was important to have opportunities for meeting your friends, for relaxation in the evening, to have more opportunities in the evening, not only in the big capital cities like Rome, London, Paris, but also in smaller provincial towns. So this was also important for women, to allow them to go out at night in a situation of safety, because obviously usually more people are out in the public realm, in the public spaces at night, usually the safer the city is. And so this idea of the nighttime economy started as a almost like a utopian idea, a very positive idea, an idea of emancipation of people, giving people the opportunity to express themselves at night. We have in Italian a song which is basically saying that people during the day have to sweat, they have to do things they don't like often, they have to do a job that doesn't really express their creativity, but at night, finally, they can do what they like, they can express themselves. If they like listening to music, they can go to a music venue. If they like playing guitar, they can sing and play guitar, they can do what they like. So this idea of the night as a moment of expression has been to some extent compromised by the commercialization of the nighttime economy in countries like the UK, in many other countries. Now the nighttime economy has been associated almost exclusively with very large consumption of alcohol. And there has been a takeover of the nighttime economy by the drinks industry, with the creation of very large bars and pubs, what I call an alcoholic agora, that has, in some cases, taken over parts of city centers, of cities like Prague, Tallinn, Bratislava, Riga, cities that have become a destination for tourists, heavy drinking tourists, often from Northern Europe, who occupy these parts of cities, and they create often conflict also with residents, because of course this type of nighttime uses creates drunkenness, drunken behavior, sometimes violence, sometimes very considerable policing costs and hospital costs, and creates a lot of noise that can conflict with the residential uses in city centers, and it can also conflict with cultural uses. For example, a lot of older people who like to go to the theater in cities like Newcastle and in England, for example, find it difficult to go because the streets are full of young people who are drunk and sometimes violent. So the nighttime economy has become also a threat in a way to urban creativity and innovation in many cities. So we go to slide number 10, which is about the rhetoric of high quality architecture. If you look at the official documents about architecture in cities, you could be forgiven for thinking that everywhere the quality of architecture today is very high. The reality is very different. This is a picture on the left of one building in the city of Leicester in England, built in the late 1960s. On the right is a much more recent building, a hotel by the chain Travelodge, which is of, as you can see, incredibly poor quality, with very small windows, with sort of plasticky exterior, with a very ugly car park built on the ground floor of the building. It looks more like a prison than a hotel. So in a way, the British comedian Peter Cook is quite right in this quote here, where he says, "I have learned from my mistakes and I can now repeat them almost exactly. So in a way, we have not really learned from our mistakes of the 1960s and 1970s. All too often, unthinkingly, we keep repeating them. Now, if we go to slide 11, we come to the idea of cultural planning as a possible answer to some of these challenges. And it's not a new idea at all. Cultural planning starts really from ancient Greece, from Pericles in Athens. Pericles was very much in favor of the integration of art into urbanism, of artists working together with architects. And in fact, often in those days, there was no difference between the artist, the architect, and the town planner. The difference really between these different professions only emerged in Europe in the 19th century. If we go to medieval Italy, the city-states like Siena in medieval Italy had very, very precise, very strong aesthetic planning criteria to specify the visual quality and cultural quality of buildings. If we go to the Renaissance, we find that people like Leonardo da Vinci, for example, Leonardo da Vinci was an inventor, was obviously a painter, and he was also an architect and an engineer, all at the same time. Vasari, Giorgio Vasari from my hometown of Arezzo in Italy, Tuscany, was a painter, was an architect who designed the Uffizi in Florence. He designed also a beautiful portico in the main square of my home city of Arezzo. But he was also a writer who wrote one of the most important books about the lives of artists in Renaissance Italy. So there was really not a specialization, a separation of art from everything else, as much as there was in the 19th century, where partly with the influence of romantic ideas, the artist became almost like a special person who was in danger of contamination by contact with the world of commerce, of industry. And this separation has been really negative for the position of culture in cities, for urban cultural policies. It was only towards the end of the 19th century, the beginning of the 20th century, that some people started talking about the importance of reintegration of culture into urban policy and urban planning. One of the most important people doing this was a Scottish sociologist, but also botanist, planner, and biologist, Patrick Geddes, who studied sociology in France with Auguste Comte, one of the first sociologists in history. And he, together with an Austrian thinker called Camillo Zitte, started advocating the reintegration of culture into urban planning. So Geddes basically said that planning is not a physical science, but a human science that has to be based on the study of three elements: folk, which means people including everything, intangible heritage, dialect, memories, legends, work, which means not only the formal economy, but also the hidden or informal economy, and place meaning not only the buildings and the streets, but also the geology of a place, the meteorology, the flora, the fauna, everything, the nature that make a part, that are part of, you cannot understand cities, he said, if you don't understand the stone on which they are built, for example. And he argued that you cannot do a plan, an urban plan, without having done first a survey of these three elements: folk, work, and place. And that he also said that cultural planning, he used the word cultural planning already, is always linked to an idea of civic renewal, by which he means the development of citizenship, the development of norms of collective behavior in cities. So let's go to slide 12. this idea of cultural planning of Geddes was unfortunately not absorbed by the town planning profession for a variety of reasons. Probably one should write a book about why. It was only really in the United States in the 1970s and 1980s that some of these ideas were taken seriously again as part of the a process of regeneration of US cities that had declined very severely with the decline of industry in places like Pittsburgh, Denver, Baltimore, and other cities. One of the key people in this process was Robert McNulty, who set up an organization called Partners for Livable Places, which still exists, is now called Partners for Livable Communities. And he started advocating this collaboration once again between cultural policy and transport policy, physical planning, economic development, and health policies, everything. So reintegrating planning, cultural planning into urban policy. Slide 13 talks about the diffusion of the idea of cultural planning. Colin Mercer was very important. He was working in Australia at the time. He learned from my work, the work of Charles Landry, and also the work of Bob McNulty. And he started introducing cultural planning in the integrated local area plans in Australia, and also in plans for new towns that in which he advocated the collaboration between cultural experts, architects, landscape designers, physical planners, economic development specialists. So basically he said, we need cultural experts to be there at the beginning. We cannot call them at the last minute. They have to be there at the beginning to develop a plan for a city. Then cultural planning slowly spread to other parts of the world, partly through courses, like I run an MA course, a master in European cultural planning in Leicester in England from 1995 to 2007. But there are still some misunderstandings. For example, often cultural plans are called cultural plans, but in reality they are arts plans. So they are not really, they don't have the breadth of a cultural plan. They are much narrower. Equally, creative city strategies are often called creative city strategies, but they do not follow the logic of the creative city idea, as it was explained by Charles Landry and myself in 1995, where we basically said that the creative city is a city that can identify creative ideas wherever they can be found. They can be found in schools, in hospitals, in the city council, in universities, everywhere in a city. And then it is about the application of creative ideas to urban policy, not just to cultural policy, but to urban policy in all its aspects. How can we use the creative ideas of people living in a city to improve urban parks, to improve public transport systems, to improve youth policy or economic development policy? That was the idea of the creative city. Now, unfortunately, the creative city label is still used, but it means little more than creative industries or cultural industries strategies. So it's much narrower, and you find this narrow use of the term in the UNESCO Creative City Project, for example. If we go to slide 14, these are some definitions and interpretations of cultural planning. The first one is by is the cultural planning as thinking culturally about public policy. Therefore, it is an approach that is culturally sensitive, an approach to urban and regional planning and to environmental, social, and economic policy making. The second definition by Colin Mercer himself. Colin unfortunately died in quite young, in 2013. He said that cultural planning is the strategic and integral planning and use of cultural resources for urban and community development. What Colin Mercer means there is that cultural planning cannot be added at the last minute. It has to be integral to urban policy and planning processes. So cultural planning therefore is not a decoration, is not something that is added as a, an element of beautification after all the important decisions have been made. So there is a problem with using a cultural element as a decoration. In the US, for example, they say it is called often the lipstick on the gorilla, where you have a very badly designed square plaza and you add a monument, an element of public art, a fountain or a statue, at the last minute as a desperate attempt to make this very badly designed public space a bit more human. This is not cultural planning. So it's not, in that case, strategic and integral. So cultural planning is also more than cultural plumbing, which means building cultural infrastructure. So cultural planning is more than simply designing and building a theater or a museum or a cultural building. And Charles Landry preferred to say planning culturally rather than cultural planning, but it is more or less the same thing. And UNESCO often say culture-based local development rather than cultural planning, but again, it is often the same thing. There are a lot of experiments in the world of artist-led cultural planning, led by individual artists or artists' agencies. Go to the next slide. Artists are particularly important in cultural planning because they have a they are able to estrange themselves from ordinary policy processes. In Swedish, the word konst, art, is related to konstig, which means strange. So this ability to estrange yourself, to look at the totality of connections between different policies, different areas of knowledge, is a characteristic of some artists. Artists who are generalists, who are not specialized in one particular area of knowledge. One of the first artists to do this was John Latham in the United Kingdom in the 1970s through an experiment called APG, which was the Artist Placement Group, placing artists in industry or in particular ministries to try to find solutions to problems. Next slide, please, number 16. So one of the characteristics of cultural planning is certainly that it is a process that is holistic, interdisciplinary, and lateral, which is based on collaborative working. We see this in a project like Città dell'Arte, or City of Art, in Biella, in Italy. Città dell'Arte is an old factory, an old textiles factory owned by an artist now in his 80s, who has decided to transform this disused factory into a laboratory where artists from all over the world work together with industrialists, with ecologists, with politicians, with policymakers, with experts in tourism, in place marketing, in many other areas. We go to slide 17. Città dell'Arte in Italy is divided into different offices, as you can see: education, ecology, economy, work, future of work, politics, spirituality, even communication, architecture, and food. Food, looking at collaboration between food and tourism, and food and other cultural forms, other cultural activities. Slide 18 is about another example of collaboration, lateral collaboration. Collaboration between artists, lighting designers, engineers responsible for lighting policy, and urban planners. So there are several projects that have led to a rethinking of street lighting strategies in different cities. One of these projects is Luci d'Artista in Turin, in Italy. Luci d'Artista means artist lights. So it was a project for illuminating the city with artistic lighting in the period just before and after Christmas. And now it has led to a rethinking of how the city is lit by organizing lighting in a different way, in a way which is more sensitive to the needs of pedestrians rather than people in cars. It is a little bit similar in Lyon, in France, where a local festival festival of light has led to a rethinking of lighting strategies in the city. Or another example is Light Night in Leeds, which happens every year in October. And some of these ideas and experiments are summarized in a book called Reflections on Urban Lighting, published by Zenobia Radzis, which I think has had some influence in Iran, I think, but I'm not sure. This is a lighting project in slide 19. This is a project for Essen in Germany, European Capital of Culture 2010. It is the special lighting of a factory, an active factory that becomes a slightly more interesting icon in the urban landscape at night, simply through some not very expensive lighting. And slide 20 is an example of the Artist Lights Festival in Turin, a rethinking of the usual images that are used at Christmas, with slightly more interesting images of planets and the moon and so on. You know, not too original, but you know, better than your usual Christmas lighting in an Italian city. Now we go to slide 21, the next one. Another characteristic of cultural planning is that it's an innovation-oriented, experimental, not narrowly instrumental process. So it is really about giving people opportunities to contribute new ideas. It is opening up the policy system to young people. It is about setting up pilot projects, research and development budgets, recognizing that an idea could fail but could lead to perhaps future success. And this is very important here to understand the difference between creativity and innovation. Creativity, as you know, is a divergent process that is about generating a plurality, a myriad new ideas. So innovation is almost the opposite. It is a convergent process where you need a different mindset, different skills. You need financial, organizational, and managerial skills to select the ideas that can be successful in terms of actually solving problems, in terms of having becoming profitable, having a market. So often, understanding this difference between creativity and innovation is crucial for also successful urban policy. Now we go to slide 22, which is another characteristic of cultural planning, that it is critical, questioning, and challenging. So I see you're asking questions, but perhaps I'll continue with the presentation. We go back to all the questions at the end. I think they are, hopefully they will be kept in the chat. So critical, questioning, and challenging. So this is a difficult one. It means that you need to recognize that there are conflicts and contradictions, but it's very important not to sweep these conflicts and contradictions. They're always there. Well, of course, in any big city, there will always be conflicts and contradictions. People want to do different things. They have different ideas. So the important thing is not to pretend that the conflicts are not there, not to hide them under the carpet, but to try to build on contradictions, conflicts, different views in a positive way. For example, in Linz, which was in Austria, the European Capital of Culture in 2009, there was a big conflict, a big uncertainty about what to do with the legacy of Hitler. Being from Linz, actually, Adolf Hitler was born near Linz, and Hitler had a big project of making Linz the cultural capital of the Third Reich. He wanted to be buried in Linz with his parents in a huge mausoleum. He wanted his favorite architect, Albert Speer, to build a series of important new buildings in the city, including a 162-meter high tower, a new bridge, and a cultural center. And some of these projects, these projects had never really been discussed properly by the city of Linz. or indeed also by universities and schools in the city, because the city was embarrassed by this Hitler legacy. And this was a problem. They were always very worried that the neo-Nazi movement or party would exploit this politically. But at last, when Linz became European Capital of Culture in 2009, they did have the courage to organize an important exhibition and conference about this Hitler legacy for Linz. And that was good for everybody, really. It was good for tourism, but it was also good to have a proper debate in schools, in universities, and the city could begin to discuss this ghost of Hitler in a mature way, in a grown-up way. And that was good, I think, for the future development of the city. And it is a little bit the same in relation to other really uncomfortable subjects like the mafia. For example, there is a museum about the mafia in a small town in Sicily called Salemi that obviously you always run a risk of glorifying the mafia if you have a museum, giving it too much importance. But actually, it is very important to understand the mafia if you are a politician, but also if you are a child going to school, if you are an ordinary citizen. So this museum has also been useful to put this little town on the map, to attract some tourism, but also as an educational, as a civic resource. So, which is often the role of culture, to be a civic resource. So we go to the next slide, 23. Cultural planning is cultured as a process. You should not be ashamed of being cultured. Being cultured means knowing about history, about the distinctiveness, the cultural distinctiveness, and the traditions of creativity and cultural expression of the past. So you have any cultural planning has to start from what I call cultural mapping, which means documenting this local distinctiveness, creating a bank of the images of a city, of a place in the past and today, and drawing inspirations from traditions of creativity and innovation that sometimes are in danger of being forgotten. So let's look at slide 24. So one example of building on this image bank is a cultural planning approach to place marketing, which has been explained in a book by one of my former students, Chris Murray. The book is called Making Sense of Place, where Murray argues that place place marketing is no different from the marketing of fashion or cars or wine. You have to design and sell the identity of a product. Actually, Murray says it's more complicated. You need, first of all, to reveal and discover often a plurality, multiplicity of identities. And you need to celebrate precisely this complexity, this layering of different images. Eventually, you have to encapsulate a communication message in one brand. This is true, but you have to start, according to Murray, with this process of very complex exploration of different layers and the celebration of complexity. We go to slide 25, where Murray shows the results of some of his research on communication strategies by in the UK, the United Kingdom, and he finds that there is a problem of imagination. Local people are overwhelmingly described as friendly. As you can see, there are 163 references in his research to the adjective friendly, only 15 to any other adjective. So this is very narrow. It's really different localities are using quite stereotyped images to communicate themselves. There are references to the past outscore references to the present by almost 5 times, as you can see. Very too much about the past, not enough about the present. And also there are lots of claims to uniqueness, 218 claims, but only 61 of these claims are specific, are based on anything specific. There are only 61 claims are explaining why the place is unique. So this is really not the way to do place marketing, says Chris Murray. Let's go to slide 26. There are many initiatives in European cities that are they have aspects of cultural planning. I've already mentioned that artist-led lighting strategies, and like in Turin and in Essen, the use of interesting festivals as catalysts for urban regeneration or for increasing the profile of cities, like the Literature Festival in Mantua, in Lombardy, in northern Italy, the Philosophy Festival in Modena, near Bologna, again in northern Italy, or the Transmusical Festival of Experimental Music in Rennes, in France. In some cases, there is a use of contemporary architecture and public art in historic environment to try to raise the profile of cities. In other cases, there is the creation of new institutes that are new institutes that are mixing scientists and artists. One very good example is the ZKM Center in Karlsruhe in Germany, which is including visual artists, musicians, doing research together with scientists, for example, doing really interesting research on image and music recording technology. Now, this is one example, not particularly the best one, perhaps, but it almost looks like a photo montage, but it is true. It's a museum of contemporary art in the city of Graz in Austria, almost as an alien object in the medieval center of the city, that has at last started the debate about the urban environment in Graz and has attracted tourists, attracted attention. So number 28, slide 28, is about cultural planning in rural areas. So this approach is not only for cities. Greg Baker in Canada explains that cultural planning can be applied to the creative rural economy idea. Equally, Ian Hunter and his group called Littoral Arts Trust have applied similar ideas to rural areas in the UK, also by establishing a rural cultural forum and rural creative industries strategies. Number 29 is about the differences between cultural planning and cultural policy. I argue that we should have the resources to allow both approaches. They are complementary, they are very different, they go very well together. Cultural policy is essentially vertical, functional, and sectoral. You need to do cultural policy, you need experts in theater, dance, music, literature, crafts, all these different architecture, different cultural forms. You need to nurture talent, nurture the audiences. So it's very much a sectoral approach. Cultural planning is the opposite almost. It's very integrated, horizontal. It is about linking cultural policy and cultural resources, cultural assets with everything else, linking it with economic development policy, housing, health, place marketing, tourism, social policy, education, health, public health, and everything else. So that's why you need two different professions to have a successful urban policy. In my conviction is that you need both cultural planning and cultural policy working together. So, cultural planning is based on cultural resources. As you can see, they go much beyond arts and media. They include sport and recreation. And it's very difficult today to, in some cases, to establish the difference between sport and art. For example, if you do some urban exploration, people who get into empty buildings climb on the roof. They do that, that is a sport in a way, but it is also a form of art, because when they get to the top of the building they often take photographs or they do a video. So the difference between sport and art is not always totally clear. In some cases it is, of course. Anyway, the cultural resources includes also the definition of includes tangible and intangible heritage, buildings, artworks, but also memories, memories and legends, mythology, and so on, is all part of the intangible heritage. Landscape and nature are both part of cultural resources. Nature reserves in cities, urban market gardens are part of cultural assets of cities. The image bank, as I said earlier, places where people socialize, where they meet, where they have a good time, where they exchange ideas. Also intellectual and scientific milieu and institutions like universities, research centers are part of the cultural resources or assets of the city. And creative inputs into crafts, manufacturing and service activities. For example, gastronomy itself, making food, a particular style of designing shop signs is a cultural resource. So we go now to 31. This is a more precise definition of the image bank. For example, the image bank of a city like Tehran or Tabriz will include how the city has been represented in the media, now and historically, in the past. How have images in the media changed? It will include the stereotypes and the jokes and the conventional wisdom used by citizens, by people. We all have our stereotypes about people who come from another city, often negative stereotypes, sometimes positive. It includes also the cultural representations of the city. So how has the city of Tabriz, for example, been represented in poetry, in music, in songs, in novels, in visual arts? It includes mythology and legends. It includes the image of a place in tourist literature, like tourism guidebooks and websites, and in marketing and promotion literature. So what kind of metaphors have the marketeers, the policymakers, the politicians used to try to promote the city? For example, Berlin, until recently, was branding itself under the slogan "the city of constant change," this idea of a young city which was in constant renewal, constant change. And lastly, views of residents, city users and outsiders are also an element of the image bank. So what do they think of the city, the way the city is promoted, the quality of life in the city, the strengths and weaknesses of the city? Go to 32. So we need to understand also that there is always, as I said earlier, conflict. There is never one dominant urban imaginary, one dominant urban metaphor or meta image. There is always a bit of conflict, a bit of symbolic contestation between different people. And this is good, because if we promote just one overwhelming image, there is a real risk of a sterile official urban mindscape that does not really represent reality and alienates people. So, for example, some people have criticized the city of Salzburg in Austria for being too reliant on the theme of Mozart, the image of Mozart, to attract people. Or indeed, people are critical of Florence in Italy, where I went to university, because the exhibitions in Florence tend to be about the Renaissance, which is the historical period during which the city perhaps was most important politically and culturally. But of course, Florence has been interesting before the Renaissance and after, so we should have much greater variety, should almost reject this idea of an official urban mindscape, official urban representation. Page 33, slide 33, is about mapping many different things. It's important not only to map the needs of people. If you do a questionnaire about needs, people will say things like, I need a better bus service at night to go to the city center. I need a ticket policy which includes cheaper tickets. But if you ask them what they desire, what it is they've always wanted to do and they've not been able to do, they probably each person and each community group in a city will have a bank of desires, projects which are what they really want to do that they have not been able yet to realize. And so it's very important to have an inventory of this project to see if the city council can bring some of these projects into being simply by removing some obstacles and constraints, not just by providing money, but by removing some of the bureaucratic problems that are often preventing people from actually innovating. So we need to understand also who are the gatekeepers, the gateways, who can open doors. Are they people working for the local authority? Are they people in business? And also we need to understand where is the local talent. What is the talent of young people? How can we recognize this talent and enable it to flourish? And this is why it is so important to have young people working together with older people like me or even older to identify this talent, because older people do not know generally. They don't go out at night enough. They don't know how the music, the theater, the visual arts, the cinema of a particular city, how it is changing. So this map of talent is very important. And we also need to know what happens in a city or in different public spaces in a city at different times of the day, different days of the week, different seasons of the year. How is the city actually used? And then we need moral, aesthetic, philosophical, organizational, and policy concepts and styles that come from immigrants as well. We need to understand how the immigrants are seeing their life in the city and what they like, what they dislike, what they would like to change. So immigrants and multicultural exchange, intercultural exchange, can be a great source of innovation as well. Important also to make innovative links between different types of cultural resources, for example, dance and food, create hybrid programs that can bring people together in interesting ways. For example, when I was working with Liverpool, European Capital of Culture 2008, we did a project which was mixing film and football. They were basically films about football, including a very especially commissioned film which followed a Liverpool football fan going to Istanbul, a Istanbul football fan going to Marseille in France, and a Marseille football fan going to Liverpool. So this project, this film about football, brought an entirely different audience, an audience that normally would not go to a cultural program, a cultural event, an audience of football fans, which was very different also from a social point of view, more working class audience. Now we go to slide 34. Cultural planning to be implemented needs different training, different specializations. You need the cultural planner himself or herself, that is generally a person making horizontal connections, able to link cultural policy with all these other different areas that I mentioned earlier. But you also need other people. You need the cultural mapper or cartographer, the person who identifies the cultural resources of a place, including the hidden resources. You need the intercultural mediator, a person often skilled in conflict resolution that can facilitate the dialogue between different ethnic communities that are present in our cities today. For example, the city where I live now, Hull in England, it's a predominantly white British city, but it has recent immigration, considerable immigration from Kurdish people, for example, have migrated to this city. So we have lots of, we have quite an important Kurdish community, and we have a total of 120 languages spoken in the city. So it, at first sight, it looks almost entirely white British, but actually there is a good 12% of the population who is not, and there are many different languages spoken in the city, both European and non-European languages. So we also need people who are able to link culture, cultural action, and policy with social policy. We need people who are able to support small enterprises through advice on finance, technology, marketing, intellectual property, tax issues, management, so all these different issues. We need people who are able to link culture with place marketing and even with property development. So people who are able to talk to property developers as they do in the United States, and perhaps be able to negotiate a cross-subsidization agreement where property developers give a percentage of their annual profits to the cultural sector, because they know that cultural activities usually increase the value of property and of rents. So we go to slide 35 now. I want to talk a little bit about the coronavirus, the COVID-19 crisis, because we cannot have a general discussion about urban policy today without talking about this. So just three slides to talk about the crisis. We find ourselves obviously in a devastatingly difficult situation, and our three countries, so Iran, Italy, and the UK, are, as you know, among the worst affected countries in the world, unfortunately. So we have a big problem. In both Italy and the UK, we have a crisis of philanthropic donations for cultural activities, because now the crisis has caused so much poverty and so much expenditure for healthcare. Now philanthropists like banks, for example, in Italy, are directing their money towards healthcare and the relief of unemployment and poverty, not to cultural activities. So we have a problem. Also, because the crisis is so huge, the number of unemployed people in the United States is exceeding probably 30 million due to the crisis. There is a possibility that politicians will think that cultural activities is a luxury that we cannot afford, that is morally not admissible to fund cultural activities. So we need in every country emergency funds to avoid the collapse of the cultural system, of the cultural sector. This is particularly a problem for the medium-sized cultural organizations, because individual artists, very small organizations, have always survived almost with no money, with very little money. And the large cultural institutions are to some extent protected even now. But it is the medium level, which is particularly important for the regional cities like Tabriz, or like the city where I am in England, Hull. That medium level is particularly exposed. There is also a big problem of exclusion, because if we have to reduce the number of tickets sold in theaters, reduce it, let's say, from 500 to only 50 to maintain social distancing, it is clear that we need to massively increase ticket prices. So this could lead to a risk of exclusion for people who are already suffering from economic poverty, but also educational and cultural poverty. And in the last few years, it is a pity, because in the last few years in Europe, there had been some progress in expanding the audience for cultural activities. There is also a rapid growth of the arts and health agenda, which in Italy is called cultural welfare. Why? Because we realize that the crisis has provoked big damage to mental health, particularly very young children, who in some cases are scared of going out now. But also the people who have suffered losses of their dear ones. There is a massive issue of absorption of the mourning for the people who have died due to coronavirus. So again, arts activities can be very important in these cathartic processes. We have seen also the very rapid development of new creative technologies like Zoom, other platforms of this kind, but also immersive technologies to try to give people a much better digital experience of cultural and sport activities. And a massive growth of amateur creative practices during lockdowns in different countries, creative practices by people who had never really experienced, had never really done any art before, people who have written songs, made videos, the all enormous boom of TikTok video, for example, is really interesting. So how do we build on this expansion, this growth of our amateur creative practices? So the next slide is 36, towards a new cultural policy agenda. So there is probably a new role for cultural institutions, including libraries, community arts projects, in areas of deprivation in cities to reduce social exclusion, to try to combat unemployment by skilling people up, by giving them, for example, access to the internet. A lot of people still don't have access to the internet, which has become so vital in this crisis, and contribute to reskilling people to try to find jobs that they have lost as a result of this crisis. So we also need co-creation projects, participation projects, to try to help deal with the psychological and social traumas, which I mentioned earlier, produced by the pandemic. And we also need to recognize, especially in Europe and the United States, the very important role of black and ethnic minority citizens who have died in disproportionately high numbers. We don't know whether this is due to genetic reasons, but more likely it is due to simply the fact that these immigrants are doing low-paid jobs in security, in retailing, in hospitals, in old people's homes, and that is why they've been more exposed to the danger of contagion, and the risk of contagion, and have contracted the virus. So how can we recognize also through cultural projects, through multicultural, intercultural projects, the important contribution of immigrants to the crisis? Finally, the use of cultural mapping methods to identify new resources for what I call post-tourism strategies, which is really tourism in your own city, discovering your own city, particularly in Iran. This is very important, it could be very beautiful in large cities where perhaps some citizens only always go to the same places. They don't necessarily go to the more interesting parts of the city. And also, how do we use cultural mapping for culture-based local development strategies? Finally, how do we remodel cultural venues and spaces? So the museum, for example, it could mean that it is no longer possible to go to a museum for free in the UK and go, if you like, you can go every day. No, it will not be possible. You perhaps will be allowed to go to the museum only once a month, but you will be allowed to stay longer, to perhaps watch and look and relook and look again at an artwork, to have more, a longer amount of time with much fewer people in the museum. Or theaters are thinking today of offering a new type of ticket that gives access to also activities in the square outside the theater, and also activities in the atrium area of the theater at the entrance, activities in the cafeteria, in the cafe, in the restaurants of the theater. And so using the whole building, not just the part of the building where you have a stage, but the entire building with much smaller numbers of people. And now we go to slide 37, implications of the coronavirus crisis for urban policies. One possible implication is that we have a shift to a new model of urban regeneration, which is the old model that dominated the 1980s, the 1990s, also the 2000s and 2010s, is a model focused on the creation of wealth and jobs. So very much an economic model. Now perhaps we need also a more curative model of urban regeneration. So a model that recognizes the importance of good air quality. Because if you don't have good air quality, you get ill. You're more exposed to the virus as well. Also a model that recognizes the importance of giving people hope and confidence to improve their mental health, to encourage people to be more positive, optimistic about the future. So a curative approach, perhaps, to urban regeneration may become more common in the future. There is also the issue of integrating the objectives of Agenda 2030 into urban policies. Like, you know, the objectives include no poverty, zero hunger, good health, quality education, gender equality, clean water and sanitation, affordable and clean energy, decent work and economic growth, industry, innovation and new infrastructure, reducing economic and social inequalities, environmental sustainability, responsible consumption and production, climate action, peace and justice. So these are some of the objectives. So how do we incorporate the Agenda 2030 objectives into new urban policies? That the crisis of coronavirus also gives us perhaps the opportunities for new forms of cooperation between cities and the rural interlands, rural areas outside cities, that have become perhaps safer and cheaper. Therefore, the rural areas could be used for artistic residences, for experimentation, for thinking, beginning to encourage artists to work again together in safety. And then the perhaps even theater shows, films could be made in rural areas and then shown in cities, either by streaming or shown in the cinemas or in drive-in spaces. There is a return of the idea of the smart city, which is a technological idea, because of course we need contact tracing, we need much more sophisticated forms of surveillance, we need much more sophisticated use of big data in managing the pandemic. Therefore, it is possible that the smart city will return very strongly. But with the smart cities, there are going to be very important issues of democratic control and governance. Who controls the surveillance system? Can we trust the state? But can we also trust private companies like Huawei, the Chinese company, for example, which is now very active in smart city projects? So there are increasingly big difficulties in Europe and also, as you have seen in the US, in collaboration between central government, federal government in the US, regional authorities, state authorities in the US, and city councils. Very poor collaboration, which is making the fight against the pandemic really difficult. And often, central government in many countries is regaining power to the detriment of cities. Cities have less power, and they are increasingly attacked also ideologically by people, either by green activists or by nationalists, by populist nationalists. Often cities are attacked as too cosmopolitan, unhealthy, unpatriotic, too permissive, chaotic, environmentally unsustainable. So there is a kind of attack on cities that is making it more difficult for cities to lead the future, to lead the new ideas for the future. Now we go to the last slide, 38. So the question is, I want to conclude with this question: can the crisis of today be an opportunity for innovation? And by the crisis, I mean a crisis which is at least fourfold. We have a climate crisis, yeah? We have a climate crisis. We have a energy crisis, of course. We have a financial crisis, and we have the coronavirus crisis, the uncertain development of the pandemic itself. So we have a risk, as I said earlier, that there will be an insufficiently high political status for culture in new urban policy. How do we solve this problem? It is difficult to solve it simply by doing impact studies, because, for example, the UK, United Kingdom, is one of the countries with the most sophisticated impact studies about the impact of culture, economic impact, social impact, cultural impact itself, educational impact. We have a lot of data, but this has not led to more investment by politicians. So it's probably important to think in terms of political mobilization. Like today, for example, in the United States and in the UK, in many other countries, the Black Lives Matter movement is really important as a form of spontaneous action to highlight the continuing problem of racism. And you know, this is very difficult because these countries, the US, the UK, many other countries, have had in place for many years race equality legislation, but despite the legislation, the problems of discrimination have continued. So perhaps the only answer is political mobilization by people to begin to put issues on the agenda. But we also need other things. We need what Charles Landry in a recent book calls the creative bureaucracy. We need a much more imaginative form of bureaucracy, where bureaucracy becomes an enabler of projects, a creative enabler, and not a block. So as one of the people interviewed by Charles Landry says in the book, behind every great project, there is a creative bureaucrat. This is certainly true in my experience. Without bending the rules a little bit, without finding creative solutions to go through the bureaucracy, you cannot really have innovative project. So you always need a creative bureaucrat. So perhaps we can also solve the problem in part through new forms of elected urban cultural leadership and through strong strategic partnerships with the cultural sector, as used to be the case in the city of Montreal in Canada, where you had a very strong cultural presence in the strategic partnership through the presence of the Cirque du Soleil, one of the largest cultural organizations in the world, that was an integral part of the strategic partnership for the city. So I want to conclude with two words by saying, if you don't do cultural planning, the problem is you end up producing cultural containers, so large buildings, often without content. So because that you may not have sufficient resources to actually program the buildings, which has often been a problem in cities that have focused their cultural strategies on building new infrastructure. And we also need, obviously, a very careful analysis of the possible audiences, bearing in mind what I said earlier about the contraction of leisure time that is a problem for a lot of audiences. And the other risk is to end up with unsustainable flagship projects that are, in a way, cathedrals in the desert. So this is the presentation.